Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. The rain has stopped, so we're gonna be a dry day, I hope, and many more to come. So I'm Fred Levering, joined today by Martha Richardson. Martha, hello.
Hi. Hello, Fred.
And John Forrester.
Hello, Fred. Hello, everyone.
John's coming in from sunny, he tells us, Kenhurst. We have Tom Gallagher. Hello, Tom.
Yo, an adventure. It's not sunny here.
Where the heck are you anyhow? So,
in Lviv.
All right, in Ukraine.
In my home, actually. I'm in my home.
And we have Fred Opalinski with us from up on the hill. How are you, Fred?
In my home. Thank you very much. Yeah. Good. And it is nice to see the sunshine and the blue sky.
Boy, isn't that the truth?
It's a miserable few days, for sure.
It sure has been. So, let's go on to the news. Now, after I prepared things today, Tom brought up a subject that has gotten some reporting, but not definitive stuff. So that's why I didn't have it on the list. But Tom, you apparently are hearing more over in Europe than we're hearing here. But this has to do with what has been dubbed Havana syndrome, which started out in a U.S. embassy in Havana, and some people that got very sick because they thought it was some kind of radio waves being directed in there at them or whatever, and there were reports that it was that Russia was behind the whole thing and so on. And then this has spread to other facilities of U.S. we'll call them agents or whatever that were working on Russia-related things that have been affected by this. But the reporting here, Tom, has not been definitive. That there has been hints and allegations, but the Biden administration has been not willing to assign blame. But you seem to be knowing more about it than we are. So, Tom, pick it up from there.
Yeah, it's actually the same reporting, and I think that most people probably would have seen it on 60 Minutes most recently.
Yeah.
And that can be, you know, made for TV kind of presentation, and a bit maybe sensationalized and also trimmed down. But this is not something that has just crept back up. In fact, it was about a year ago that five of the intelligence agencies at the U.S. said that they really did not see any evidence for a foreign malicious actor out there. They didn't have an explanation for this, and I'll fill in more of the history here, but it is still inconclusive. But why reporters would be keeping on this case to me is actually very interesting after you have intelligence agencies out there. So it's not unanimity out there, and the medical community who's seen these folks and their injuries do not recognize it as anything that could be certainly psychosomatic at all. So explanations are really thin for what's happened, because these are visual injuries inside these people that doctors are seeing. So they actually think that some of the first cases might have actually been in Frankfurt before Havana. But it was the prevalence of the cases in Havana that got people taking notice of it. But some of the cases are also from like Tbilisi, Georgia. And what I think these investigative reporters have done that wasn't done apparently by the intelligence community, which is a bit surprising, is actually linking up Russian intelligence assets to the locations where people were when they experienced their conditions in the worst and most severe cases. The other thing, again, this is circumstantial evidence, but a large portion of these people at the Department of State and various different intelligence agencies were working on Russian-related projects and were known to be doing so. So you put a lot of this stuff together and you're going like, yeah, it doesn't sound like the complete story to say it wasn't some sort of weapon. And we do know that even going back to Soviet times, here in Ukraine, the Soviet Union was working on microwave radio frequency weapons, mostly for electronic warfare, combating electronic elements out in the field. So like you think of drones today, one of the things you can do is shoot bursts at it to basically knock out its GPS to make it ineffective. Well, could the same sort of technology be used on people to create ailments? Well, the medical community, if you actually look up the OSHA thoughts, this is the occupational health and safety people for the United States, on exposure to microwave radiation in these forms, is that the symptoms match up a lot with what these people have experienced. So it's there's a number of things that you're just going like, okay, there's no evidence pointing towards a weapon being used, but what in the heck was it, and why can't anybody figure it out? So
Why it, wouldn't this stuff be detectable in some way? I mean, you could. I'm sure there are sensors that would detect microwave activity.
So a lot of these events actually happened at their homes or hotels. So it wasn't necessarily being done while they were in embassies.
In their offices. And,
yeah, and so what? Some of the more damning evidence is, and there's weaknesses in this. But one of the women who was the wife of a diplomat in Georgia, in Tbilisi, Georgia, she was hit with this pretty badly, acutely. And we should also say that these people, many of these people have been knocked out of work. They are on disability for the rest of their lives. Many of them have to have surgery, et cetera. So this is not like, oh, I've got a migraine headache that comes every 2 weeks. It's constant kind of things like that. And these people were asymptomatic before any of this. I can't say that for everybody. It's over 100 people that we're talking about, but a lot of those that were showcased in all of this. She was at home doing the laundry when this happened, but they had security cameras outside, and they actually picked up on the camera somebody they suspected was a known Russian agent that was working in Tbilisi with this unit that is working on radio frequency weaponry and systems like that out of the GRU. The GRU isn't really what it's called anymore, but that was the Soviet abbreviation for their military intelligence operation. We often think of the KGB. KGB was really more like the FBI, was more involved in domestic things, whereas the GRU was more of the international arm of Soviet intelligence.
Yeah, Tom, I believe on the 60 Minutes report, they started it off with a Russian national who came, who was trained in electronics research, and came to the United States and started working as a chef. And he was on several of these chef competition programs. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, he didn't keep a low profile, but he was arrested speeding in Florida, and they found all kinds of odd electronics in his car, and shortly thereafter he fled back to Russia, and the reports were that he was then sent to the front in Ukraine and killed there or died.
Oh, okay. I heard about that story before, maybe it was a year ago, and it sounded vaguely familiar. I didn't know it was involved and in, included in the 60 Minutes reporting. That's interesting.
Yeah, that's how they let off the report. But, there are a lot of holes in this story.
It is. There are. And, sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. But what the CIA basically said last year when they came out with this was, we do not want to diminish in any way what these people have suffered. This is not at all about, we just can't connect what they're suffering from to a weapon system. But the thing is about this conspiratorial is, there's reason why an intelligence community would actually want to keep this hush-hush for a while.
Right. If they, if they so, had had similar weapons.
Or if they're really trying to figure out what it is that they're up against, and they want to try and make it look like they know less, like they're unaware. You don't want to know that the enemy to know that you're on their trail trying to figure this out, or that you're coming up with countermeasures to it. So there are reasons for that. I am not saying that that's the reason why the report came out as it did, but you can come up with that and just say, okay, I can see why they're taking the strategy they are. And then we're talking about going back to 2014, 2016. So this has gone through Obama, Trump, and Biden, and has basically stayed quiet through that whole time. I think it's been basically being kept quiet largely by the intelligence community. Again, I don't know why reporters would be keeping on the trail of this if it looked like it was such a dead end. And I can definitely imagine that there are people who are knowledgeable, much more knowledgeable than the average person would be, who are telling them, don't give up on this. It kind of makes me think of what was the name of the Woodward Bernstein film?
The President's Men.
That's what I thought. You know, where he's basically, when they're running in the roadblocks, they're getting a little bit of a nudge every once in a while from
So most of this reporting is U.S. based, you know, where you have 60 Minutes that we referred to and some other things that have been on our side of the Atlantic. Are you hearing anything over there, Tom? It seems like if the Russians were behind this, that they would be using it against the Ukrainians as well or whatever.
Here's kind of an interesting twist on that I'll give you from a personal note, but actually the British media is involved in this as well. That's where I've been getting a lot of the reporting on this side that is more interested in taking this up with more vehemence. But I can tell you that I've traveled around much of the world since the war's begun. There is no place that I feel safer than in Ukraine. Anywhere else, if somebody were to choose you as a target, it's very easy for Russian operatives to be working anywhere else in the world. And it's been shown by them taking out people, assassinating them in parks in London. But it's very difficult for them to get into Ukraine. So yeah. Ukraine would not be the place where I would be expecting them to be using and sneaking in things that they could use in the civilian way. We've had about 1,000 people who have been indicted for treason. That's not terribly surprising at this stage. I was just reading up on this. Most of them are for targeting, assisting with targeting of you know, things in cities and factories and things of that sort.
Well, one of the things that is on my list today is that I read about some Chinese hackers attacking U.S. and U.K. infrastructure, particularly in America here, water systems, where they've tried to disrupt a lot of that stuff is automated these days, and it messes up with the additives, the chlorine or whatever that's put into water in order to make it safe for human consumption and stuff like that. And they've been messing with that kind of American infrastructure. Again, Tom, are you hearing any of that on your side?
Oh, I mean, that stuff's been going on for years. They're constantly probing systems and looking for that. The one thing you reminded me of, though, is that there's allegations that the Chinese have used microwave weapons against the Indians already in the border clashes that they've had. That's one of those other things that out there. Again, nobody's actually come up with a photo of somebody holding something and saying this is what they used and all that, but there's allegations that they've used that in the past. But the hacking, the information war, oh my God, all that stuff is just a daily occurrence. I can't really put my finger on what you're talking about as far as like something specific like that, but that has been happening quite regularly. And the fact that we do it to them as well.
You know, we're not just the victims of these things, aren't we? Aren't we well on our way to doing a lot of the same things?
Yeah, I would
imagine.
We are worried about the cyber capabilities of our geopolitical adversaries right now, but I would still say that the U.S. probably has the upper hand, and the NATO with the allies and all that, they have the upper hand. And let's remember, after Yes We Can, there was Yes We Scan with the Obama administration when the Germans and several of our allies found out that their phones were being tapped back in the Obama years and all that. So,
well, staying on the infrastructure sort of subject, you know, we've had some conversation about the Key Bridge in Baltimore. There's talk now about, all right, now it's got to be rebuilt. Who's going to pick up the tab? President Biden said that the feds will take care of it, but he had no, there's no, you know, bill in Congress or whatever where the spending has to originate in the House and then be approved by the Senate before it gets to the president's desk. So who's going to pick up the tab? I mean, this whole thing seems to me to be, we got to regard this as a freak accident and not be pointing fingers at anybody in particular. We're going to learn about what we can do to prevent such things, as we've talked a bit about before. But isn't it an opportunity for a lot of different levels of government to work together to expedite the permitting?
And it's supposed to be, according to the Federal Highways Act, all major interstate projects are 80% funded by the federal government, 10% by the state government, and I think it's more than that, and 5%, I think it was 5% funded by local government. And from what I've read, it's they're talking about 80-20 federal state funds here.
Mm-hmm. Well, the insurance claims, I mean, it's one of the articles that I read said that it may be the largest insurance claim ever filed at $1 billion. So I don't know how all of that fits in, and that may be years in the making once it goes through courts and all that sort of thing. Of course, the bridge needs to be cleared up and rebuilt as soon as possible, and can't wait for that stuff. But
along those lines, though, Fred, one of the things that I did read, that there is some really, really old maritime treaty or act of Congress or whatever that basically limits how much the companies involved can be on the hook for it. And it turns out to be, it's going to be a fraction of what this thing's going to cost to rebuild.
Did you say 1851?
1851.
Okay.
I don't know if that's going to stand up in court, but the thing that the insurers and the carriers are worried about is the wrongful death. That's the main thing. It's not the bridge replacement that they're worried about being on the hook for. It's that there's deaths and there's people injured, and there's going to be suits on that front. And so who's responsible for those things, I think, is where a lot of that's going to be. There's people in the business communities, particularly in transport in Baltimore, who are concerned about what this impact is going to be on their businesses, and they could lose their businesses. They could maybe have to declare bankruptcy and all that. That there's almost no chance that there will be any recourse for them in the courts against insurers or the cargo carrier or whatever.
Yeah, I predict that this is going to be cleared up lightning fast. I mean, you saw what happened with the I-95 bridge collapse in Philadelphia, and that was done in weeks. I think this is going to be this is going to be a massive project and move along speedily, because that's an important port.
So the clearing of the channel is going to be speedy, but I don't think the construction of the bridge will be speedy.
No.
Yeah. Okay.
But there are other bridges. There are other bridges in that area.
And I think that they're going to be smarter about the kind of bridge that they do put in there, because they're going to probably, you know, give it a lot more elevation above where the ships are, and then also make the span a lot more robust.
Well, that's exactly right.
The Chesapeake Bay Bridge is several miles down the bay from Baltimore, and that's pretty much the same construction. Although they do have what they call those dolphins around it to protect it from being butted by a cargo ship. However, if it ever were, it's the same construction and the whole thing would collapse.
Yeah, I don't think there are any ports. There aren't any really deep water ports that are north of that bridge. You know, that's basically Annapolis going over to Watts Creek area or something like that. There's really not much up there. I mean, you got basically Havre de Grace up that way. And then the further down by the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay is the Bay Bridge Tunnel, and that's why they have the tunnel, because then they just go over the tunnel.
That's the bridge you're talking about.
Oh, is it? Okay, that one. Yeah, they sail over the tunnel.
Well, there's going to be, taking out any artery like that is going to create enormous traffic congestion until people figure out ways around it and whatnot.
Yeah.
And that leads me to another infrastructure thing. This is on I-95 in Northeast Philadelphia, where a truck that was escorted by the police and had all the right permits, where they measure the heights and whatnot of the route, was carrying some enormous cylinder of some sort. I don't know exactly what its use was, but it was being hauled somewhere, I believe, for scrap, and it nailed a railroad bridge. And that has shut down I-95 for several days, and they hope to have it finished by Friday, I guess, is what they're saying. It was another, as John was saying, something that was done very quickly, but in the meantime, it caused enormous headaches. And this just kind of leads you to thinking about how dependent we are in a very mobile society on these various forms of transportation infrastructure. And we've been behind in most states in doing the proper maintenance and stuff. We're just behind on it. In fact, the guys that are still, their bodies are missing, presumed dead, and the two that did get plucked out of the water that survived were actually fixing potholes on the bridge. And if you've lately driven the West Shore Bypass around Reading from, say, Penn Avenue heading down toward Exeter, there are a couple of bridges, the one by the old Ireler generating station of MedEd's, and then another one a little further down, it crosses the Schuylkill. I mean, that it's really, you've got to really pay attention, because there are significant sized potholes that open up on that thing, and you can see where they've been repaired, and now another one shows up next to it. And that's on a bridge that is slated for renewal in the next, you know, who knows, 10 years or something like that. But think about what would happen to the Berks County economy if the West Shore Bypass were shut down, that, you know, for any length of time. I mean, we're so dependent upon it, and there really are not a lot of alternate routes. You can get over into the Shillington area and pick up 724 down toward Birdsboro, but I mean, we're really dependent on the West Shore Bypass. And
I think I remember, is it 50 or 60,000 cars a day that travel that? That's an enormous volume for this little city. Just think of what that would mean.
So, and then you can take those numbers and kind of interpolate it to think about how many cars are on I-95 in Northeast Philly. I mean, it's got to be a lot more than 50 or 60,000. So infrastructure stuff has been kind of, we're looking the other way, but it's the chickens are coming home to roost, I think. There's been a lot of talk about this social media thing called TikTok, that apparently enormous numbers of the young people in our country are spending tremendous amount of times messing with. I got to admit, I've never been on the thing. I have no clue. Somebody'd have to tell me even how to get on it. But nevertheless, there have been allegations that this thing is a Chinese company called ByteDance, I think, BYTE Dance, which is a Chinese-owned company and owes its allegiance and its existence to the Chinese Communist Party. And apparently all the information that's gathered on this thing is somehow sent back and they create systems where they can influence how people think about things and whatnot. I mean, it's I don't think there's anybody back in Peking that's really dates me. That is sitting there figuring out what am I going to do with Fred Opalinski's, you know, social media account, but they add millions of other Fred Opalinskis and they come up with these systems that are beyond my comprehension.
Yeah, but this information is something that everybody gathers. I mean, Facebook gathers it, Google gathers it. Every stroke you make on your computer, at least if it's hooked up to the internet, you're being counted and traced.
The difference here, though, is that Facebook isn't reporting, how we use Facebook back to Beijing. That's the difference. So to complete the thought, then we'll talk about it. What's going on in Congress is some legislation that will force TikTok to either divest away from this ByteDance or ban it, that it won't be allowed to be used. So now, John?
Just this week, our state legislature tabled bills that would ban TikTok on state-owned telephones. It would, I'm trying to think, there were three parts to the bill. It was tabled by the Republican-controlled House. I don't see it that this is a national emergency. I don't see that it's even a partisan issue.
You certainly are competing commercials right now on television that run back to back, one the condemning TikTok and how dangerous it is for children and how quickly children can be lured into unhealthy practices. And then the next one is a commercial with all these business people who are surviving and have thrived because of TikTok and what would happen to their businesses if they took it on.
Most of them have Southern accents.
Have you noticed? Yeah, have you noticed?
Yeah, what surprises me is this is a fairly new company. I mean, it's not been around all that long. And you've got however many millions of people saying they cannot live without it. I mean, somehow this has become so embedded in personal psyche or business vitality. I mean, that's just mind-boggling to me. I can't imagine a new technology so taking hold of a significant number of people that it could throw a presidential election if the wrong decision is made.
Excuse me, another part of that bill was that anything that is generated by AI must be so labeled. Uh-huh. And that went down in defeat.
What's going on with the TikTok? First off, with the social media, there's three platforms that are very popular that are similar: Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok. Facebook and Instagram are owned by Meta, which is basically what was formerly Facebook. Facebook definitely leans towards an older crowd. I think there's a few people on here that are using that. Instagram, a lot less verbiage going into it, a lot more images and videos, and it's much more of a scroll and entertain you kind of thing. That's going to be more of your middle to young adult area. TikTok is very much young adult in the teens, and it's the same thing. It's a very fast user interface that where you can just do a video, put it up there very quickly. It's very easy to turn things out. So what the vulnerability is partly that if you're using TikTok, whatever your account is could be monitored by Beijing, whereas Facebook and Instagram do not have that. And that's why the government people are not allowed to use it. So that's one of the vulnerabilities relatively easily addressed. The other thing that is much more of a concern as far as our democracy is at stake is that John's right that all of these things lead themselves towards misinformation. But when it's actually coordinated by a foreign government with the intent to create chaos in the system, and I'll use an example. There's been people, and these are probably domestic operators, but they could be actually employed or just the useful idiots of foreign governments, who are saying that there is a ship in the San Francisco Harbor with this name on it, and it is taking weapons to Israel. And it is encouraging young people to go there and board this. Well, these are U.S. naval vessels, and in this particular case, it's a refueling vessel, and it wasn't going to Israel. But these people protesting, climbing on this ship, will be arrested and can spend years and years in jail and have their futures destroyed by the misinformation that has encouraged them to go down and protest on the sake of the Palestinians by a bunch of people who don't care about what happens to these people. And so these are the things that are pretty easily stirred up and do happen on a pretty frequent basis.
The thing is that TikTok is only partially owned by Chinese firms, or a Chinese firm. And
isn't it entirely owned by the firm, but partially owned by the state?
I'm not sure what the state has to do with it, but if they can access the information gleaned from the private corporation, the private ownership, it really doesn't matter whether the state owns it or not. They can own the information, and it's not owning the information. It's not what they glean from it. It's what they can. It's the disinformation that they can spread on.
Well, and that's Tom's point. I mean, there's no doubt that the great wish for China and Russia is to disrupt our society, divide us, and bring as much chaos as they can.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah, sure.
It's been going on for years.
Right.
Yeah.
And so how do we stand against it? I mean, if politicians aren't even willing to have AI labeled as such, how do we separate truth from fiction?
I can say from using Instagram, I don't use TikTok, but from using Instagram, I am of the suspicion now that more than 50% of the accounts that comment on something particularly political or social, are bots. They're not real people. They could be people, but they're not representing that interest there. And they might have numerous accounts. There's ways you can go through and find out which ones these are by doing a little research and all that. But right now, so much of what's getting commented on, the other flip side of this, what we were talking about before on this disinformation, and that these companies have, you know, they can pull all this information as well. There are a lot of restrictions, particularly in Europe, on what they can do. And in fact, one of the biggest difficulties for people who are on YouTube presenting about things with the war, be it in Gaza, be it in Ukraine, they get demonetized regularly by YouTube for things that seem completely arbitrary. YouTube will not tell you why, but they're just going to say, you're not going to make any money off this video, and we're going to bury it, basically. And it could be that there was an explosion somewhere in the video, but it might not have been anything, really. So, because they have a policy about not showing people getting injured. That's one of the things that you're not supposed to do.
YouTube.
There isn't anything like that on TikTok, really. What's that, John?
YouTube was invented by a Berks Countyan. Two students at Twin Valley High School came up with YouTube. Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And it's now owned by Alphabet, which is Google.
The defense always seems to be, we have freedom of the press and we cannot restrict that, which to me is a ludicrous argument. Because any newspaper has an editorial board that decides what gets in and what doesn't, what's appropriate and what's not. And I don't see any difference between what happens in a community newspaper and what happens on a national media platform. I mean, it seems to me that the same kinds of things can take place. You can have somebody doing editing for the well-being of the community.
Fred, do you know how many people get their information from newspapers these days?
No, but I'm saying, why isn't it the same? Why isn't it, if freedom of the press did not restrict editors from deciding what got printed and what didn't, why can't we have the same sort of concern about what goes into the minds of our young people and adults?
And because newspapers had editors who had addresses. As a reporter, I had to publish my name, address, and phone number in the telephone book. That was a rule. I mean, we didn't have anonymity. We couldn't change our names on our bylines. And newspapers had physical plants. You knew where to go bark to the editor. You could show up and request to see the editor and air your grievance. You can't do that. Show me where YouTube is. Show me where, you know, you can go to Hacker Way, Palo Alto.
Well, but that could be changed. I mean, if people, you know, if this is important enough for the well-being of our society, we can't just be glib about it and say, well, whatever happens, happens.
But this is the part of the argument about how TikTok is different. So YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, they are actually required to follow rules of where they are. So if you're in a different country, they will actually be different rules on what you can watch. And those providers, those platforms are responsible for that and policing that. And they get fined regularly. And it was Apple that's getting fined more so recently and all that. But Facebook has been up against it and had to pay some fines in Europe recently. There's no way of doing that with TikTok because it's not enforceable. You either ban it or you actually put it within the jurisdiction of wherever the users are. And that's the argument that the U.S. is basically making in this case, is that they need to have that. So they actually have some authority to be able to do this. But it's a very difficult line because most of these firms are using things like AI and algorithms, and they are just terrible, blunt instruments. There is nobody, person who's scanning all this stuff because the content is so much more than we would ever have imagined 20 years ago. I mean, anybody can be a publisher, basically.
Well, it really boils down to what's the intent of the information that's gathered. As John said, this has been going on. I mean, have you ever looked on Amazon for a particular product and then found yourself flooded with offers of something similar and so on? I mean, they track and they can kind of profile all of us and know whether you lean to the right or to the left or Republican or Democrat or if you are straight or gay. I mean, there's all sorts of things that can be gleaned from the information. But it's mainly in America been used for commerce or to direct political advertising because they think you're a likely person that'll vote the way we want you to. The difference with TikTok is this business where nothing is owned privately in China that the government, and therefore the Communist Chinese Party, has something to do with. And that's where the disinformation threat that John referred to really comes into play.
By the way, go ahead, John. You go.
It's not true that some things are owned privately in China.
I think what he's saying is it's vulnerable to being nationalized at any point in time.
Right. Exactly. And we've seen that. I forget the guy's name. The funny looking little guy.
Jack Ma.
Right. He apparently was one of the richest men in the world, and then he disappeared.
Yeah, well, he's around, but yeah, he's disappeared from the face of our, you know, social understanding and all that. One thing, just with what Fred Levering was saying, for viewers out there, if you're curious about this, Google has been required to actually make it so that you can turn those features off. on your browser if you want to. So that is something new. But most people, when asked about it, is just like, well, you know, maybe I'm going to, if I'm looking for men's suits, maybe I want to see a Hugo Boss ad pop up. Maybe I want to know whether there's going to be a special on these sort of things. So most people probably aren't aware that they can do that. But yeah, you can turn those things off. But when you're on YouTube or Instagram and you kind of like, what's MSNBC, you know, and those kind of folks, you're going to get really irritated if there's a lot of stuff that's coming up from Fox News or something like that. And so it's eventually going to see what you're clicking on and what you're saying you're not interested in. And it's going to give you what you want. And that's the echo chamber.
All I see on Instagram is kittens, kids doing stupid things with soda bottles, and scantily clad women on roller skates. I mean, what's that say about me?
I don't want to go there, I'll tell you, but let's
John, you're let's... supposed to have one real account and one fake account. That's what you're supposed to do, okay?
Well, let's talk about some other stuff. I understand that there is an enormous increase in the number of people that when they're booking a trip, and it's going to entail going somewhere on an airliner, that they are able to research whether or not it's a Boeing 737 MAX, and if it is, they go somewhere else. That the increase in people looking to avoid 737 MAXes has increased by like 15-fold since Boeing began to have these problems. Now, Boeing was one of the just shining stars of America and is now, I mean, in chaos. Have any of you ever worried about flying on a 737 MAX?
No.
I've
seen the same stories that you have, and I see people who are posting about that on social media, on YouTube, or these news comments and all that. They do not realize that there are thousands of 737 flights every day. This is the most common one. Now, the MAX is the specific one that they're worried about. But there are hundreds of them out there, and they're doing probably four or five flights a day. You know, they're short-haul flights. So these are not... This is not something that's, you know, is going to highly likely. And I remember an ex-girlfriend flying across the Atlantic, very nervous about flying. And when she arrived over here in Europe, I showed her, I was like, you know, on the sky scanner, like all the other airplanes that were in the air going from North America to Europe at that time, it was hundreds of planes that are up in the sky all the time, every day. And so people are just not aware of the frequency. But when you go to Google Flights, which is a site, you can actually see what the airliner is when you're choosing your flight. So it doesn't matter whether it's a 737, it can be an Airbus A320 or something. So that's been out there, and that information's been out there all the time for people. But they do have to put it up there too.
And if you compare the problems with Boeing airplanes with
Airbus.
Subarus, oh. Fords, Chevys, Hyundais, flying is the safest way to fly.
Flying is the safest way to fly, good.
I think you might have meant travel, but nevertheless, it's okay.
And it is interesting that this event that caused this was domestic. No fatalities, certainly scary for the people that were close to the plug, but there were two fatal crashes that involved the MAX early on because of the system that it involves that assist, supposed to assist pilots to keep the plane from stalling on takeoff. And the pilots just were not properly trained. Whose fault that was, whether it was Boeing's or the airlines, was the question. So this is the first time that this kind of thing came up. And it's interesting to me that this was the one that actually got people worried about and looking into these things, whereas the other two were not one because I guess Egypt and Indonesia, I think, was where they were. That didn't really stir people so much.
Well, let's talk about some important things here with the wars. Tom, you always give us kind of an update. I understand that there was a Russian oil refinery and a drone plant that was east of Moscow, some 700 miles from Ukraine, that Ukraine apparently targeted with drones and hit it successfully and caused a lot of damage. Is that an escalation? How do you see the reaction to such a thing?
So, to me, it's not surprising. One of the problems that Russia has by being so vast is that so much of it is indefensible. So you move your air defense systems to one corner of the country, you're exposing another. And this is just basically the game Ukraine's playing. They've developed a lot of these long distance, unsophisticated drones, slow moving. I think the one you're talking about was actually a civilian aircraft that was refitted to be remotely controlled. So these are the kind of things that are doing very basic stuff. But you fly it low. You just keep it low. It stays out of radar. People in Russia aren't tuned in like we are. Like, we have an app on our phones that we actually can report seeing missiles. So I'll even show it to you here. So this one, this guy here, this red one in the corner, I got that one there. That's actually for reporting when we see cruise missiles or something. In Lviv, we don't get that. And that's also one of the reasons why they fly at night. We'll hear the sound, but we can't see it. We can't take photos like we can with the app.
The other thing that the Ukrainians are doing is they're packing relatively cheap passenger planes, single engine, slow flying Cessnas built in Pennsylvania. With explosives and retrofitting them with automated,
remote control.
And they're basically just flying them low altitude, slow speeds, and the Russians on the ground look at it and say, "Oh, it's a passenger plane. They're not going to worry about it." And then boom. Because there were photos on the internet, and you could see that they can carry 1,000 pounds of explosives.
Yeah. So the interesting thing that's come up about this as a tangent is that all these Western governments are saying is like none of our weapons were involved. Ukraine saying none of the Allied weapons were involved. Which is not very surprising, but I think it's so funny that they're being so vehement about that. And then you have today, Antony Blinken, Secretary of State, saying that Ukraine will become a NATO member. That, I think, is one of the most interesting things that I've seen in the news.
I've not heard that.
Yeah, it was today. There's a NATO summit in July, and Stoltenberg, who's the head of the Secretary General of NATO, was talking about his plans to try and actually make NATO the entity rather than the U.S. With the Rammstein group meetings to be the one that will actually be the funnel and the collector and take things into Ukraine, so that this is some way of them hedging their bets against a Trump presidency in the future, so that, basically NATO and European allies are much more involved in controlling how this all works. Now, the problem is that, they're talking big euro signs here, where the money will come from and who's going to put their hands up with that. But the interesting part about that to me is that I really wish they would stop talking about dollar signs with these things, because it's actually not money that's involved. It's the material that they already have that they're contributing. And they're assigning a monetary value to that to show people like what's the magnitude of it. Well, if it's a couple tanks or if it's several hundred kamikaze drones, I think is probably more important to me, because it tells me about what capabilities they're delivering to Ukraine, what capabilities they're seeing as being important. And so I don't really need to know the euro signs, but it's politicians and they have budgets to worry about. And this is how they report these things, is, a drawdown of small.
Tom, didn't I read recently that the Ukrainians are saying, well, we really don't need the F-16s anymore. They're kind of outdated in this war.
I haven't heard that, and I can basically think that maybe where it came up with is that they're seeing small drone warfare as basically their bread and butter.
Yeah. The stuff that we're talking about. The F-16 is a fighter plane. I mean, it fights other planes.
It's not like, it's, Well, it's not
like A-18, which is an attack plane also.
Well, it's a multi-role fighter. It can actually deliver a payload. It's just not going to be a huge payload because it's a single engine. The F-15 is going to carry more. But it is multi-role, and what multi-role means is that you can actually equip it for both. Send it up in the air, give it some air defenses, but you're putting it on a bombing mission. But it can actually engage with other fighters up in the air. Where they're going to be really useful is not necessarily always in an attack position, but you can basically scramble your fighters, go after cruise missiles, because the fighters are much faster than the cruise missiles and the drones. They can identify the ones that they're worried about. They can, you know, go after those guys. And they can actually just use guns to go after much of the stuff. I mean, Tom Cruise in Top Gun would be loving this, because most fighter pilots these days don't get to go to their guns on things. They got to use missiles. Well, they want to conserve the missiles. So they're shooting down dozens of drones and all that. And that's one of the things that's really valuable, and it can replace shooting a Patriot missile, you know, at something that is a tenth of the value of what the missile is. So it's the math that they do is like, what is it possibly going to hit, and how much damage is that going to be compared to the price of the missile? It's not what's the price of the drone or the cruise missile that they're taking down. So it's a very, very difficult situation. When you don't have enough ammo, you have to be judicious, and that's why Kharkiv right now is just getting hammered. Almost all the electrical infrastructure around the city of Kharkiv has been hit. People are speculating that they think that it's because the Russians are going to make an effort to put the city under siege. It is so much larger than any city that they have dealt with so far that it is unlikely, and a lot of people think that they're just doing this as a decoy to make the Ukrainians move more forces in around the Kharkiv area in a defensive measure. So that will be one of those things that will be an interesting defensive measure. The other thing you might have seen in the news is that they're talking about 300,000 new conscripts coming into the Russian military.
Over the age, yeah, to 25,
That's in Ukraine, so from 27 to 25, and I think that's way overdue. That was on Zelensky's desk for almost a year. But the Russians are actually doing more conscription, but this is part of their annual conscription. And these conscripts are not actually supposed to, whether or not this is going to be enforced is anybody's game, they're not actually supposed to leave the Russian Federation. They're supposed to stay in there. But that includes Crimea now, as far as Russia's concerned, and it can include those four oblasts. So it's just they're not supposed to be doing offensive measures. That frees up other people to basically take on offensive positions by moving them into the rear positions.
Well, that kind of segues us toward the Mideast, where Israel is also talking about increasing the pool of potential conscripts to serve in the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force. And there's some controversy about some of the religious aspects as to some of the people that might be subject to that. But in both Gaza or Israel in the Middle East and in Ukraine, in addition to running out of munitions, they seem to be running out of bodies, that they're increasing who might be eligible to be drafted and so on. So in Gaza, I found it interesting that the last thing I read was that support for the war effort in Israel has dropped from last November. It was like 55% of the population. Now it's like 36. That there's a lot less support for continuation. And meanwhile, Netanyahu is insistent upon going after Rafah, that last city where they think Hamas is hanging out. And the support for that, and whether or not Netanyahu is going to be subject to elections again. His current term runs through 26, but elections could happen a lot sooner than that. So where does it go? And meanwhile, the United States is still dragging their feet over monetary support.
Well, apparently Biden and Netanyahu have had or are having a conversation this morning. Biden asked for an immediate ceasefire and said that any aid that we gave them, that we give Israel, will be dependent upon their how they address civilian harm and humanitarian suffering in Gaza. And so I know we're planning to sell them jets, but I'm not sure how that sale will be affected by that statement. But I guess that was the line that Biden said, if we help you, you're going to have to make some, you're going to have to make some changes in the way you're operating.
It was long overdue.
Indeed, indeed.
Well, the thing is, first of all, there are two political careers at stake here. One is Netanyahu's. If he starts drafting the ultra-conservative Jews, he's gonna run into a his own wailing wall. I mean, it's they are pretty radical, and they're not gonna fight for Netanyahu, who's not necessarily. He's trying not to look as secular as he is, okay? But he is, and I believe his political days are numbered.
His political life is toast.
Yeah, and
as long as what's going on, he may be able to stay there.
It's over if he goes through with his conscription plan. Meanwhile, Biden has done everything wrong in this war. He has just alienated. He's alienated his left. He's alienated the right. He's not appeased the middle. He's I don't know whose advice he's listening to, but he has done absolutely everything wrong in this war. And he's really slipping in the eyes of the world as far as a leader, and I fear for his presidency, his reelection bid.
Well, on that note, we're going to have to wrap things up for today, but it sure sets us up for next week to get further into those kind of comments that John's been making. Before we leave, I do want to make note, the last Pearl Harbor, Arizona battleship survivor has passed away. A gentleman by the name of Lou Conter, he died at the age of 102. He's the last guy that was on the Arizona when it was hit. Now, he's not the last Pearl Harbor survivor, but he's the last one from the Arizona. So we got to thank him for his service. 102, what a guy. We used to have people that showed up at the 4th of July parade in Wyomissing, and there's none coming anymore. I mean, it's really a sad thing, but that's the age these guys were at. So on that note, we're going to have to say goodbye. Panel, thank you very much for your insights.
Can I just say the Jazz Fest starts this weekend?
That's right. Yeah, Berks Jazz Fest this weekend. It's become such an ingrained part of the area, it's almost as if I didn't need to say it, but thank you for bringing that up. But
okay.
Audience, thank you, and we'll look forward to sharing some time with you next week. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.